Lerner is the co-founder comes regularly and has been with the organization since its beginning. Michael, as many of you know, founded the Commonweal Institute, which is in Bolinas, California. He started the Smith Center with Barbara Smith Coleman and Shanti, a MacArthur Award Fellow, and has literally written the book on Choices in Healing. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Michael.
Thank you, Jackie. Can everybody hear me clearly? In the back, you can hear me as well. Good. Jackie, thank you. And you were being modest. You are the board chair and playing a very key role in Smith Center's work. So thank you deeply for your service. And I also want to recognize Annette Pollan, who is here and on the board. And Annette, could you just stand up so people can see you for a moment? Annette is, some of you know, an extremely gifted painter. And actually, I was given as a gift for, I guess, close to 17 years of chairing the board, a portrait that Annette is doing of me by Smith Center as a gift. And I was over with Annette this afternoon as she was putting the finishing touches. And to watch, not only to watch, but to collaborate with an astonishingly gifted portrait painter is a remarkable experience, because what I think we both figured out, I mean, you knew it, Annette, but I didn't really know it, is that there's a way in which when you're working with a gifted portrait painter, she can capture something that no photograph can capture. And what she captures is sort of the essence of the human being. And that essence is also what is called the soul. And the soul is also an archetype. But in capturing the essence, there's actually a soul-to-soul communication between the portrait painter and the subject, so that neither Annette nor I could really say what was going on, except there was some form of nonverbal communication taking place that resulted in this extraordinary, for me, piece of work. And so I'm so grateful to you and to Shanti and Smith Center for giving me a gift that I will cherish all of my life. Perfect. I know. So thank you very much. So I want to dedicate. Some of you who've been here before with me know I often dedicate these talks to somebody. And I want to dedicate this talk tonight to Shanti Norris, the executive director of Smith Center. Shanti and I knew each other before Smith Center because we were both students of a yoga teacher, Swami Satchidananda. Shanti was actually Swami Satchidananda's secretary. And when Barbara Smith Coleman and I were looking for the right person to lead this, and I knew that I'd had some really good experiences hiring people from this tradition of yoga, because I knew I could trust them and I knew I shared values with them. And I knew that the people who had the hardest job in all of medical yoga were the people who served as Swami Satchidananda's secretary. And Shanti was one of the truly outstanding people Satchidananda's secretary. So I invited Shanti and Barbara to get together. They became fast and deep friends. And Shanti really became the embodiment of the spirit in which Barbara Smith Coleman left half of her estate to found Smith Center and to carry on its work. There are really three or four traditions that come together in Smith Center. One was Barbara Coleman's lineage, and she was a Georgetown matron who lived with a tremendous amount of both physical and emotional suffering in her life, and she knew that this suffering had brought her down into her own essence into a soul place. She was a very close friend of Annette's, and her suffering had shaped her into this extraordinary being. She had taken her brother to a center where I had gone when I was exploring cancer therapies called the Bristol Cancer Help Center. And there she found, in Bristol, England, which had been opened by Prince Charles and was a center that I grew on when we started the Commonwealth Cancer Help Program 30 years ago. And there she found this transformative experience, both for her brother, who later died, and for herself. So when she came back, she asked who was doing this work in the United States and found I was doing it out in Bolinas, California. And so she came out, and ultimately we ended up working with Shanti, the three of us together, creating the center, which is now 20 years old. So for 20 years, Shanti has given her life to Smith Center. She's given her heart and soul to Smith Center. And she's held a single vision that I'm going to just single out three dimensions of what it means to me, what she's done. The first is that she's dedicated herself to helping people heal in the face of a life-threatening illness like cancer. The second is that she has understood the power of yoga, meditation, support, and art in deep, intentional healing. The third is that she has been singularly dedicated to healing from the societal wounds of racism, poverty, and injustice. So it's the combination of these three things, a deep sense of the power of intentional healing in the tradition of yoga, but not only yoga, in the tradition of support, in the tradition of art, how these things can come together to unlock healing potential that medical therapies don't touch. The medical therapies are involved in an effort to treat us medically. Healing is a whole different story. It's a movement toward wholeness. And that movement toward wholeness is really what the great Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung meant by individuation. Have people heard that term, individuation? It is a movement toward being our true self. So when illness or when loss of a job, loss of someone we love, loss of our hopes for a certain kind of life, whatever it is that we hope for, when we experience losses that unalterably change us, we can't tell our old story anymore. We can't go with what the ego wanted us to be. And where do we go? We go to the soul. We go down into the soul. And it is in the soul where we find the powers of creativity, of grief, of love, of loss. It is in the soul, in that nonverbal place, where tremendous healing potential is held. So Shanti has understood this. She has carried these lineages of working with loss, of working with injustice and racism and poverty, and working with the healing power of contemplation, prayer, meditation, yoga, support, art. And she's held all these three things for 20 years. So it's in that spirit that I dedicate this talk to Shanti. There's another friend who's going to be in town in a few days who cares about healing.
Tomorrow.
Right? He's a humble man. He was born of Italian immigrant parents in a suburb of Buenos Aires. His parents actually almost died on the boat that they were supposed to take over to Buenos Aires. The boat that they were supposed to take, it took them a little too long to sell their confectionery shop in Italy, so they had to postpone it. The boat that they were supposed to take sank, and all the Italian immigrants in steerage died. Pope Francis, when he first came to power, what was his first act? It was to go to an island in the Mediterranean where the migrants were landing, many of them dying, and hold a mass using, you know, an old wooden boat that had transported them as the place from which he did the mass. Francis understands marginalization. He understands oppression. Do all of you who want to understand who Francis is, there's this extraordinary biography, they have it at Kramer Books, I picked it up there and I just hadn't been able to put it down, called The Great Reformer, Francis and the Making of a Radical Pope, by Austin, I think, Ivory, is how you pronounce it. His story is extraordinary. The story is extraordinary. Now, what is Francis? Francis is an archetype. Francis is an archetype. He is an archetype of a very ancient quest, which is the quest for healing through the power of love and mercy. And that archetype is also the archetype of Christ, and it is the archetype of the wounded healer. That is to say, it is no accident that Jesus, who was a healer in his ministry, was also somebody whose principal message to the world was love and mercy, because love and mercy are the greatest healers of all. So this archetype of the wounded healer, the Christ, the teaching of love and mercy, and how love and mercy is completely transformative in healing, is who is coming to town. That is who is coming to town. In the notes for the talk on the website, just so I remember to say something about what I said I was going to say, it said, each of us carries a map of our psyche and a map of reality, in quotes, within us. We often don't realize how deeply these maps affect our sense of who we are, where we come from, why we are here, and to whom we are accountable. Our maps of who we are. Do you think you know who you are? Where we come from. Do you think you know where you come from? Why are you here? Do you think you know why you're here? And to whom are you accountable? Those are deep questions. You know, there are different archetypes of the nature of the universe. The scientific archetype of our time tells us that the universe is dead, that it has no meaning, that it is a purely physical phenomenon that started with the Great Bang, and that human life is the result of random chance. That is the scientific archetype of our time, and science is the authoritative language of our time. Now, what a strange archetype to live in, that the universe is dead, that our lives have no meaning, that we essentially have no purpose here. That if we have a purpose, it is simply that we make it up. It's essentially an existentialist point of view. Now, I honor existentialism. If your view is that the universe has no meaning except the meaning that we attribute to it, that is an honorable position to take. But it isn't the tradition that created humanity and that humanity has held for 250,000 years. Remember in the 1950s, the Time magazine had this headline saying God is dead, and that everybody expected that religion was just something that would die off, and that we would be guided by science and rationality? Well, look where we are today. I'm not sure that science and rationality alone have solved our problem. And as for religion being dead, It isn't. Nor is the spiritual power behind religion dead. You may or may not be interested in religion itself, but the quest for meaning, the quest to understand who we are, is a pretty universal human quest. Whether you call it a spiritual quest, or an existential quest, or a philosophical quest, or simply a practical quest of some kind in your life, we all hold some effort to make meaning. And our efforts to make meaning are archetypes. So, our archetypes, another way of thinking of archetypes, is that our stories are filled with archetypes. Our stories about who we are filled with archetypes. In the Commonwealth Cancer Health Program, we've been doing these week-long retreats at Commonwealth in Bolinas, California for the last 30 years. We've done 175 of these weeks. And, you know, when people come, most of them are women. Most of the women have breast cancer, by no means all. Most of them have metastatic breast cancer. Many of them are young women with metastatic breast cancer trying to figure out how to say goodbye to their children. That's the world I've inhabited for the last 30 years of my life. And I can tell you that there is no greater miracle in my experience than the fact that these young mothers who are facing the hardest thing in the world, which is not their own deaths, but leaving their children without a mother, that somehow, by some grace, going inward in this condition of excruciating loss, they find a different way of being with this story. They find a new way of telling themselves their story. And often what they find is to ask themselves, how do I want my daughter to remember me? Do I want my daughter to remember me as somebody who was so agonized that all I remember is her grief? Or do I want my daughter to remember me in a different way? And by asking themselves that question, they often come to a deeply transformed sense of how they want to spend whatever time they have left. That's a change in story. It's a change in archetype. So changing our stories when we go inward in the face of deep loss is changing our archetype. So I went on to say, we also don't realize how deeply these maps influence our ability to heal. So these archetypes that we carry, our stories, have a profound impact on our ability to heal. I remember a young woman on a recent cancer health program, again, with a metastatic cancer and a four-year-old daughter. I was astonished by how she moved from a sense of complete overwhelming suffering, physical, mental, emotional, to a sense that she had begun to re-own a life worth living. It didn't change the diagnosis. It didn't change, perhaps, how much time she had. Although I will tell you, when you reach deeper into yourself and find a way of living at peace, one of the things we know about cancer is that it feeds on stress. Stress promotes the growth of cancer, right? So if you can find a more peaceful way of living with it, it may not only expand how much life you have, expanding your sense of who you are, but it may extend life as well. So the maps we developed earlier in our lives may or may not serve us well as we continue our journeys in the face of great loss. So that's the point of this deep inner work, is to find ways of living that serve us better. And there's something about being human which is most astonishing, that in the face of deep loss, we don't say, I wish I spent more time at the office, right? We don't say, I want to go out and buy a fancy car. We go inward to a deeper part of ourselves about what matters. And what matters is almost invariably the people we care about and the people we love. You know, it's a strange thing when you have a serious loss, whether it's illness or something else. There was a saying that one of the people on the last cancer health program had, which I never heard said so clearly. The saying was, when you face a cancer diagnosis, she said, friends become strangers and strangers become friends. Just so beautifully put. There are people who can't handle it, who back away from it, you know, who just can't be there. There are other friends who not only are with you, but step forward. But then there are the people who you weren't close to before, who show up. And who are those people? They are the midwives and angels of this movement towards soul. And in the ancient tradition, what were they called in the original peoples all over the world? These people were called the shamans. The shamans were the women and men who, from the beginning of human history, they had had what was called an initiatory illness themselves. They had been very sick. They had been taken to death's edge. And while they were at death's edge, they discovered that if they recovered, they wanted to dedicate the rest of their lives to helping others on this journey. And they also discovered that the greatest danger was not physical death, but soul loss. And so what they knew was that to accompany others was to ensure that there was not soul loss. Does that make sense? So, let's look at the origins of the idea of archetype. And here I just am going to kind of expand our sense of what does this word mean? The word archetype means the original pattern from which copies are made. The original pattern from which copies are made. And it came into English in the 1540s, and it derived from a Greek word which means first mold, the first mold from which you make other copies. And that comes from arche, meaning beginning or origin, and typos, which means pattern or model. So the beginning model is an archetype. Now there are four closely related ideas in our use of archetype today. And the first is that an archetype is a pattern of behavior or an idea which other patterns or ideas emulate. And the second is from Plato, which was the great Greek philosopher Plato. Plato had a sense that there were these pure forms, ideas that were the essence of cat, or the essence of dog, or the essence of something else. And that what we saw in the world were copies of that original idea. Now that Platonic idea actually has been revived by an extraordinary British philosopher and scientist named Rupert Sheldrake. And Sheldrake has developed the concept of morphic resonance. That is to say that what makes a cat actually is a vibrational field that all cats are formed by. That it's not just genetic inheritance, that you know there's a vibrational field. So this idea, the Platonic idea, has not gone away. Moreover, if we look at Platonic ideas more broadly, it's not just about caste. It's about ideas like love and service and mercy and things like that. And we can ask ourselves whether those core ideas don't exist somewhere in pure form. You know? Now, where do they exist in pure form? They exist in literature, in paintings, in mythology. When you think about Carl Jung, as that was actually going to be the third one, is Jung's sense of what an archetype was a collectively inherited unconscious idea or pattern of thought or image that is universally present in individual psyches and that shows up in myths all around the world. So when I talked about the shaman as an archetype, Jung called that the wounded healer. And the wounded healer was an archetype. The Christ is an example of the wounded healer. As I said to you, all over the world, in every original culture, you had these wounded healers who had almost died, and then, when they survived, wanted to dedicate the rest of their lives to this work. I can't tell you how many people we've been at in the Cancer Help Program, or quite honestly, people on our board, who either have been close to death themselves or have had somebody they love die. And that experience changed them so fundamentally that they needed to dedicate the rest of their lives to this work. So that is the wounded healer archetype. That's one of the, but there are many others. Jung talked about the wise old man or the wise old woman. You know, there are all these different archetypes which show up in mythology all over the world, and they show up in our dreams. They show up in dreams, they show up in literature, they show up in songs. So that when we look at our dreams, when we look at the art on the walls here, when we look at all kinds of things, if we begin to think, what part of this is just the artist's fantasy or my individual fantasy, and to what degree am I participating in an archetypal reality that is beyond any of us as individuals? So, those are the four: a pattern of behavior, Plato's pure form ideas, Jung's collective unconscious ideas, and a recurrent symbol in literature, painting, or mythology. Now, Jung treated archetypes as psychological organs analogous to physical ones, in that both are morphological constructs that arose through evolution. In other words, Jung felt that these archetypes weren't just some airy-fairy abstraction, that they were as authentic and real as a physical organ, as your liver, as your kidney, as your heart. So for Jung and for Joseph Campbell, you know, the fact that these things showed up all over the world meant that there was something real there. And in fact, if you think about it, archetypes can be realer. In other words, if you think about the ordinary reality that you live in, and then you think about, you know, the experience of an archetype, which feels more real? So let me give you the most obvious example. Have you ever fallen in love? Because if you've ever fallen in love, deeply, truly in love, no matter whether it lasted a short time or a long time, no matter whether you were ultimately disappointed or ultimately ended up with a person, falling in love is a profoundly archetypal experience. It's one of the most powerful of all archetypes. Notice that we say we fall in love. Swami Satchidananda used to love to riff off that. You know, that we fall in love. What happens? We realize that our conscious egos and our ideas about what a good idea is, in quotes, is no longer in control. That something has seized us so powerfully that we can't control it. We can fight it. We can either do it or not do it. But we aren't in control. Or we're hanging on by our fingernails, you know? We are no longer in control in a fundamental way. So the two greatest human archetypal experiences, I believe, are love and loss. Montaigne, the great French essayist, summed up his view of human experience. He was, by the way, not at all interested in spiritual life. He was an empiricist. But Montaigne had four words for what life was about: survive, love, and loss. Survive, love, and loss. And so whether you take Montaigne's perspective, which is just that it's a matter of survival, or whether your path is to go deeply into love and loss, because that is the best strategy for surviving love and loss. So rather than simply a grim survival, you ask yourself, is there a way for me to live with this experience of love and loss that deepens me? So when you are deeply in love with somebody, what happens? What happens? Your sense of time completely shifts. That person becomes very closely linked to whatever your idea of the numinous is in your life. The Sufis have an experience for this, a word for this. The Sufis say the friend leads to the friend. The friend with a small f leads to the friend with a big f. The friend with a big f is the divine in the Sufi tradition. It's God. So the friend with a small f leads to the friend. When we're in love with someone, many of the traditions have understood, it leads us as close as many of us get to our experience of the divine. And it may be that it doesn't turn out the way we thought. It may be, even if we end up married to the person, that we make the transition from being almost inevitable, from being in love to loving the other person. And as Jacob Needleman, the great San Francisco philosopher, says, love, when you move from being in love to loving, then it's work. In other words, when you are loving somebody as a partner, it's very different from being in love, you know. Then it becomes work. He says it's joyful work. Well, I'm not sure it's always work. But the point is that at that point it's work, you know. So these two fundamental human experiences, the archetypal experiences, how we deal with loss and how we deal with love, are sort of fundamental. I mean, imagine for a moment that you were deeply in love with someone in college, and for whatever reasons you couldn't really get together, and you meet them 20 years later. What do you think happens? Right? All the power and energy of that original love tends to explode again, right? And then maybe you meet them 10 or 20 years after that, right? You know, there's this evolution, but you know that you have been deeply significant in each other's life. And very often, the fact that it didn't work out is part of what makes it so powerful. There's a beautiful line, it is the obstructed brook that sings. It is the obstructed brook that sings. You know, it is when love is obstructed in some way that it is sustained in the most powerful way, the in-love experience. Because when you end up with the person, there's no longer that sense of, you know, can't get enough of each other. You're together all the time, for God's sake. You know, it changes, it shifts, right? In a fundamental way, no matter how much in love you were. And trust me, I mean, my wife and I have been married for 30 years. I dearly love my wife. But any of us know that a 30-year relationship has many seasons. It goes through many, many different things. James Hillman, the great archetypal psychologist, talks about how each of us is like a boarding house. And each of us had in our boarding house many different sub-personalities. And some of them come out by day and play by the rules. Others of them come out only at night and come out and play by very different rules. And there's a third set that never come out of their rooms at all, right? So when we fall in love with somebody and marry them or get together with them, guess what happens? Two boarding houses come together. And so at first we're all on our best behavior and we're trying to put out our favorite characters in our boarding house. But over time, there's this whole set of other characters that have to learn how to live with each other. And that's the work of love, right? That's the work of love. So there's a psychiatrist that many of you have heard me talk about called James Hillman, who took Carl Jung's idea of the archetype, and he created an almost purely archetypal psychology, which he called a psychology of the soul. And he went back to a great Renaissance Neoplatonist named Marsilio Ficino, who was a very extraordinary man. He was kind of the Socrates of his day. He was kind of short and squat and ugly like Socrates, and like Socrates, he was brilliant beyond words and widely recognized as, you know, bringing the treasures of the Greek world into Roman society at the critical period of of the Renaissance. And Ficino's concept of the human psyche is worth describing, because we usually think of soul and spirit as referring to the same thing. But for Ficino and for Hillman, the image was like this. There was the body, there was the soul, and then on top of the soul was the spirit, okay? And the soul was the dark, moist part of us that holds all our sub-personalities, or almost all of them, and moves very slowly. It takes time to digest things and metabolize. The spirit is like mercury, it's like quicksilver. It wants to shoot up into great abstractions of spiritual life and being peaceful and all these wonderful things that we aspire to. But when the spirit goes shooting off like that, the soul feels abandoned. In other words, the spirit wants us to be good and be perfect and be peaceful and meditate and be compassionate and do all these things, whereas the soul is dealing with jealousy and anger and all the other human stuff. And so whether you conceive of the soul as having a lower part, which is what we're calling soul now, and a higher part, which is what we're calling spirit, the point is that they're different. So when we think in the West of four parts of ourselves, we have a physical dimension, we have an emotional dimension, we have a mental dimension, we have a spiritual dimension. We leave out soul, all right? And soul was the way Marsilio Ficino and James Hillman thought about that dark, moist part of us that stays very close to the body. Hillman and Ficino both said that if the soul didn't exist, the spirit wouldn't have anything to do with the body. It would just soar off into these great expansions. It is the soul that mediates between the body and the spirit and holds it all together. So again, that's another archetype. It's an archetype, it's a way of understanding. But ask yourself this, which do you prefer, Ficino and Hillman's model or Freud's model of the id, the ego, and the superego? They're very similar. The id is, you know, well, it's the organic self. The ego is more or less the soul. And the superego is the spirit, you know. But honestly, I think that Ficino and Hillman's model is a better model than the Freudian model. I think that, you know, it's very close to Jung's model, and that is the one that I have found most useful. So, forgive the abstractions, but so now I'm, you know, I want to talk about some types of archetypes. The purpose of all this is to expand your sense and my sense of the variety of inner resources that each of us has to live our lives in a more spacious way. That's the purpose of all this. And to do so by talking about the different archetypes that inhabit us, both individually and as a community and as a country and as a world. So here's some just at random different kinds of archetypes. There are mystical archetypes like the Jewish Kabbalah or tarot cards or the I Ching or astrology or the Sufi Enneagram. These are mystical systems that typically have a number of different ways of being. There are the archetypes, very powerful archetypes of the family, what it means to each of us, the father, the mother, the son, the daughter, the husband, the wife, the lover, the friend, you know, what those archetypes mean to us. There are the mythological archetypes, that I talked about Joseph Campbell drawing on Carl Jung. For example, the hero's journey, that's absolutely an archetypal thing, as is the wounded healer. Then there are, you know, we're so proud of the fact that Western monotheism, the prophetic traditions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, we're so proud of the fact that they have a unified God, one God. But in creating a unified God, we actually lost, and this was James Hillman's point too, we lost the richness of the many gods that inhabited the ancient world. So, for example, the Greeks had this whole pantheon of gods on Olympus. And they didn't think of these gods as abstractions. They believed that each of us as a human being could be in the power of a different archetype, whether it was the archetype of love, or the archetype of war, or the archetype, you know, all these different archetypes. So when they got sick or when they were troubled, the question they asked their guides and therapists was, which archetype is inhabiting me so I know which god to sacrifice to? So when we created a monotheism, a single god, we lost the incredible variety of archetypes that the polytheistic traditions had. The Hindu pantheon of gods is an equally good example. These pantheons of many gods were actually in many ways better guides to our inner life than a single god. Because the single god has one nature, more or less. You know, I mean, the best we can do with a single god is to say, you know, there are many rooms in my mansion, right? Meaning there are many different ways of relating to them. But the pantheons made it possible to identify all the different gods. Then there are the ancestral spirits in Chinese and African cultures, but also in the experience of many of us, I'm sure, in this room, who feel that a loved one continues to communicate from the other side. You know, now the ancestral spirits are very powerful archetypes of somebody who is still with us. You know, Barbara Smith Coleman, I'm sure for Shanti and me, is still very much with both of us. I have a friend named Brendan O'Regan, and it's funny who the people are who stay with you from the other side. I wouldn't have expected Brendan O'Regan, who was an extraordinary man, to stay with me, but he's one of the ones who's closest to me, you know? So there are these spirits that many of us experience of people we have loved that in some sense stay very close to us. And we don't necessarily believe it's just an interjection. We often believe that this is real. In fact, it may be realer than real, as I've said archetypes so often are. Then you think of some principal religious figures: Krishna, Buddha, Confucius, Lao Tzu from Taoism, Moses, Christ, Muhammad. Many of these were actual people. Buddha, Confucius, Lao Tzu, Moses, Christ, and Muhammad. I mean, not Moses necessarily, perhaps. Krishna probably was. But they all became archetypes. We built onto them these incredibly powerful archetypal structures. And there are contemporary archetypes, like Mother Teresa, like Gandhi, like Martin Luther King, like the Dalai Lama, like Pope Francis. These people carry for us enormous archetypal power. Popular culture is filled with archetypes. Romantic comedies, action movies, horror movies, dramas, cartoons, genres of song, country and western rock, all the rest. Celebrities, politicians, political parties. You think of bleeding heart liberals versus authoritarian Republicans versus do your own thing libertarians. All these are archetypes of how different people see the political world. One of the most powerful conveyors of archetypes to us is advertising. Advertising has enormous psychic power. It avoids consciousness and goes right into the unconscious. And what is the primary archetype that ads offer us? That we are consumers. That's the archetype. That by consumption, we will find love, we will be powerful, we will be rich, whatever it is. That whatever hunger we have, they do this meticulous research into all our hungers, all our needs, and they target us with something that goes right down into the unconscious. So that we think it's our idea that we want a new car or a new dress or, you know, whatever it is. But in fact, the unconscious is for sale. It's been commercialized. There's a way of thinking about archetypes that I use a lot. It's a tradition of psychology called psychosynthesis from an Italian, like Pope Francis, named Roberto Assagioli. And Assagioli was a student of Jung and Freud. And he created a model that's so easy to use that I use it a lot just to describe how archetypes work in it. If you think of the psyche as a circle, and see the circle as trisected into a lower unconscious, a middle unconscious, and an upper unconscious. And then in the middle of the circle is a point, which is the observing place from which you witness everything. There's no content, it's just your witness self. And then from that witness place, you can see, if you look carefully, a whole set of different sub-personalities. Remember Hillman's idea of the boarding house? So those are the different sub-personality. So a way of coming to know yourself for Assagioli is you sit down, you can do this at home, and you make a list of what are your sub-personality. I am a mother. I am an artist. I am a yoga teacher. I am, you know, a wife, you know, whatever your list is. And then you take this list, or let's say you have 8 or 10 principal ones, and you write one of them on a different pieces of paper, and you put the pieces of paper in a circle with a blank piece of paper in the middle. And you stand on the blank piece of paper, and you practice the process of identification and disidentification with each one. So you stand in the center and you step into the mother one. This is what it feels like when I'm purely experiencing myself as a mother. You step back, but now I am back in the witness place. This is what I feel like when I experience myself as a daughter, but then back into the witness place. This is how I feel when I experience myself as a yoga teacher and back. The truth is that we run through this constantly in the course of a day, but without consciousness of moving in and out of these different sub-personalities. When you discover that you can identify and disidentify with each of these things, it gives you more spaciousness. So if you're caught, let's say in a relationship with your husband, where he's in a sub-personality and yours, and it's just horrible, you realize, oh, here I am in this victim-wife consciousness or whatever it is that you want to call it, but I can step back from this to my observing place, or I can step into my yoga teacher place. You know, you have some space to move. That's the whole point of this conversation, is that it creates a spaciousness where we can see that our responses to the world often come from these different sub-personalities within us. And by being more conscious of them, we gain freedom. We gain a little more freedom with which to move. So this is a kind of technical point, but it's an interesting one. Behind each sub-personality that we identify is a complex. So for example, when you said you have a mother sub-personality, there's a mother complex in psychological terms behind that. And behind every complex is an archetype, the archetype of the mother. So you have your experience of yourself as a mother. You have the complex of what it means to you to be a mother. And you have the archetype of the great mother. And those are sort of three places, three stations of your cross, in a sense, of what it means to you to be a mother. I'm going to talk just a little bit about this Sufi, or maybe not Sufi, it comes from a bunch of different places, but I want to recommend it to you all, if you're curious. The Sufi concept brought to the West by a Russian mystic named Gurdjieff, of the Enneagram. And I want to ask, how many people here have heard of the Enneagram? So some, okay. So the Enneagram is a circle, And it's actually based on the seven deadly sins of Christianity plus two more. But sin not in the sense that we use the word sin, something awful. Sin in the original Greek sense of missing the mark. You know, a sin in the Greek sense is not some god-awful thing that you've done. It's just that you're a little off there, you know. You're trying for something, but you're a little off. So the nine points on the Enneagram, and here's the difference between this and astrology. In astrology, you're given your archetype at birth. So I was born October 22nd, 1943. I'm a Libra with Libra rising and a Leo moon. I can understand myself in those brains. You know, the Libras are the lovers and diplomats of the universe. You know, the Leo is the part that likes to get up in front of you. So, you know, I'm very balanced, you know, I'm quite mental, you know, peacemaker, all that good stuff. So, so I can understand myself in those terms. But my friend Jeremy Walensky, with whom I had breakfast this morning, was telling me about an experiment that they did in a psychology class where they handed out to the whole class an astrological description and said to them, this is your, you gave us your birth sign, your birthday, and here is your reading of your astrology, and tell us whether it fits. So like 80% of the class said, yeah, it's amazing that fit. Well, what they didn't tell them is they gave them all the same.
Yeah.
So what's going on there? See, this is where archetypes get really interesting. Because if you've ever thrown the I Ching, which is a Chinese, how often is it uncanny how the I Ching speaks to you? Or if you use tarot cards, how often has it been extraordinary that you drew that card? So what's going on? So it seems to me that what's probably going on is that when you do one of these things where you're asking the unconscious for guidance, and you get a deep archetypal reading, it constellates something in you that enables you to respond as if that reading were personal to you. But it doesn't mean that the reading isn't personal to you. It means that by going there, you have enabled the unconscious to constellate in a powerful way that speaks to you, right? So when we fall in love with somebody, we all have the feeling that this person is completely unique, that how did we find each other, you know, my soulmate, all that good stuff. But the truth of the matter is there are probably a couple of thousand other people that we could have fallen equally deeply in love with. So, you know, something is constellated in us by these experiences. Or when we have a huge loss, you know, we may feel that our loss is completely unique. We may feel that, but what has happened with love and loss is they constellate a movement into the unconscious. Why? Because our existing framework can't cope at the cognitive ego level with what's going on. So we have to go back to the source. And the source is the soul. And in the soul, we find these sources of creativity and strength that enable us to move forward and to enlarge our story, which is what we're talking about. How movement into understanding our sub-personalities, the complexes behind them, the archetypes behind them. It gives us a sense of spaciousness with which to live. So the archetypes drop us down into the unconscious, the source of power and meaning and creativity. They give us a way of interpreting the world, of telling our stories anew. They also connect, and this is for the psychologists in the room, they connect with our ego defense mechanisms, like projection or denial or identification or introjection. So for example, you know, the art exhibit on the walls here, racism is an incredibly powerful form of projection. It is projecting onto those who, you know, we feel we can do this to. Our own negative fantasies, fears, everything else. It's asking them to hold that part of ourself that we're not willing to do. But it's not also only race. We do the same thing with social class. You know, we do it with people on the margins are vulnerable not only economically, they're vulnerable because they are asked by the society to hold the projection, the negative projection, which in turn deeply influence their self-awareness, their self-esteem. These are archetypes. We are asking those on the periphery to carry them. And this is the power of Pope Francis, by the way, which is he goes to the margin and he says, these are the sacred ones. These are the children of God. These are the ones we are asked to hold. And he says to pray for the grace to be able to feel their suffering and pain. Not to buffer yourself with indifference, but to pray for the grace to feel. You know, when you see the refugees coming from Africa and Syria and the Middle East into Europe, hundreds of thousands of them, and you see those images, this incredible flood of humanity, none of whom wanted to leave their countries and home, but it became insufferable. And so there's this vast, vast number. And you see from South America and beyond, the people coming up through Texas, through the South. And you hear politicians saying, both in Europe and the United States, let's build a wall. Let's build a wall. Let's hold the suffering off. Let's leave them on the margins. Let's build a wall. These are archetypal material. These are profoundly archetypal material. So, let me come back to a focus on the archetypes of healing. Healing, by definition, takes place when we're wounded. And so when we are deeply and unalterably wounded, not just a passing wound, but we have been deeply and unalterably wounded, then we have to find another story. We just have to. Our old story won't work. And so that is when we go, I'm just going to say it again, into that inner place which in every original society, there were specialists called shamans who accompanied it. And who do we look for when we're wounded that way? We look for people like Shanti or fellow sufferers with our cancer or whatever loss we have who can accompany us in this unfamiliar territory while we get our bearings and find our way. This dimension of illness or loss of any kind is at least as important as the medical interventions. Yet our medical system offers us only the medical interventions, which can be great if they're done skillfully. But the healing part is almost completely ignored. Or done in a partial way, like, oh yeah, we have a support group that meets in this room with no windows down in the basement. You sit on metal chairs in a circle and complain about your doctor. That's not what we're talking about, Charles. We're talking about something much, much, much deeper than that. So our old stories about who we are don't work, and we need a newer, deeper story. And finding that story, again to say it, is to become closer to our true selves, to move closer to who we are now. And that is what Jung called individuation. You know, I mentioned that the Sufis were especially understood spiritual friendships. And their great story of spiritual friendship is the story of the poet Rumi and Shams. Has anybody heard of Rumi and Shams? So Rumi was, he's actually the most popular poet in the United States. You know, great Rumi and Hafiz. If you don't know Rumi and Hafiz, do yourself a favor, get their poems. They're just incredible Sufi poets of love. And in fact, I'm going to read you a poem. poem by Hafiz. I've read it here before, but I love it so much that I haven't read it yet. It's called In a Treehouse. Light will someday split you open, even if your life is now a cage. For a divine seed, the crown of destiny, is hidden and sown on an ancient fertile plain that you hold the title to. Love will surely burst you wide open into an unfettered, blooming new galaxy, even if your mind is now a spoiled mule. A life-giving radiance will come, the friend's grace will come. Oh, look again within yourself, for I know that you were once the elegant host to all the marvels in creation. From a sacred crevice in your body, a bow rises each night and shoots your soul into God. Behold the beautiful drunk singing one, that's God, from the lunar vantage point of love. He is conducting the affairs of the whole universe while throwing wild parties in a treehouse on a limb in your heart. See, that's Sufi poetry. That's the friend leading to the friend. A Western poet who understood Sufi wisdom was Rilke. Here's a book, a poem from Rilke's Book of Hours. God talks to each of us as he creates us, then walks with us silently out of the night. But the words spoken to us before we start, those cloudy words are these. Sent forth by your senses, go to the edge of your desire. Back behind the things, grow as fire, so that their shadows lengthened will always and completely cover you. Let everything happen to you, beauty and terror. Only press on, no feeling is final. Don't let yourself be cut off from me. Nearby is that country known as life. You will recognize it by its seriousness. Give me your hand. See, these poems take us down into that soul place. Here's one more Rilke poem that I adore. She who reconciles the ill-matched threads of her life and weaves them gratefully into a single cloth, it's she who drives the loudmouths from the hall and clears it for a different celebration where the one guest is you. In the softness of evening, it's you she receives. You are the partner of her loneliness, the unspeaking center of her monologues. With each disclosure, you encompass more, and she stretches beyond what limits her to hold you. See, these are the poems of the soul. And so if we're interested in finding soul, we do well to look for it in art and music and movement and dance and poetry. And we do well to find the original pieces that have power for us, rather than being content with what advertisements and commercial archetypes drive us. So I think I'll close. I mentioned Rumi meeting Shams. And you know, when Rumi met Shams, he fell off his horse. When Paul heard the voice of the Christ, he fell off his horse. Pope Francis describes how he was pulled into a church at the age of 17 as if he were physically seized. He said, as if I were physically seized. And he likened it to falling off a horse, right? So again, falling in love Rumi fell in love with Shyam. Paul fell in love with Christ. Pope Francis fell in love with Christ. We fall in love with whoever or whatever it is that we fall in love with. But it is by what and who we love that we know ourselves. I think it was Aquinas that said that. It is by who or what we love that we know ourselves. And love and loss have this great commonality that they seize us by a force that is beyond us. We're no longer in control, and a destiny that we did not expect beckons. So I don't know if this has been useful to you. You know, when I come to Smith Center, I really don't know what I'm going to say until the last minute, and then I sit up in the office and try desperately to pull the pieces together. And that's what I did this time, too. But I hope that if nothing else, this evening opens you to the possibility that whatever loss you are facing, or whatever situation in life you are facing, that it's possible to find meaning in it. It's possible to live with it in a way that may be radically different from what you thought originally. That you don't have to live with it from the place of the ego's plan for our lives. That we have a resource within us. And whatever you call that resource, whether you call it God or Christ or Buddha or Muhammad or Krishna, there is a light in us all. There is a light in us. Or you can call it a pet or your husband or wife or nature or whatever it is. Whatever form that light comes to you, there is a light within us. And when you kindle that light, it is like lighting a candle, and it dispels a tremendous amount of darkness. And in that light, and by that light, the light of love, the light of laws, we can find our way. So thank you very much for listening to me, and I'm happy to take a few questions if you'd like to ask them. But those who need to leave, please feel free to leave, and we'll hang out with the folks who want to stay. Actually, I know there's a, reception. And so I'll hang out there too. But let's just do a few questions first, and then we'll go to reception. Questions, thoughts? Yes?
Michael, when you're talking about sub-personalities that are within our soul, and you showed that you can move back and forth between them. But isn't there a struggle between them?
Yes. The question was, when I talked about the subpersonalities and we can move between them, but isn't there a struggle between them? Great point. Let me actually say, in a Jolly system, which I think is true, we can be aware of the subpersonalities in the middle unconscious. By definition, we can't see the ones that don't come out of their rooms, which are down in the lower unconscious. But we also aren't necessarily aware of the ones in the higher unconscious. And we can become, while Freud thought we just became neurotic because of trying to suppress the ones from the lower unconscious, Assagioli and Jung both realized you can become equally neurotic from trying to suppress your higher self. So if you have within you an experience of Christ energy or Buddha energy or whatever you want to say it, and you're suppressing that, that can make you just as pained as suppressing one of the lower drives. But yes, the subpersonalities are often at war with each other. And so what Assagioli taught was that it was useful to name them, to claim them, meaning recognize their parts of you, to tame them, try to get them to work a little better together. And then if you can get them to work better together, to aim them. So you name them, you claim them, you tame them, and you aim them. Now, that's the ideal. But in fact, Lenore Leffler, who was one of the great co-leaders of the Cancer Health Program, both here and in Bolinas, who died a few years ago, just an incredible woman, she was a great psychotherapist, and she would often say, people usually come to me because they're having trouble with one of their subpersonalities. So, you know, that's a way, there's an aberrant, in other words, you think you've got your life together, but there's this one sub-personality out in left field that's just giving you a horrible time. You feel terribly guilty about it. You don't know whether to give in to it or continue to suppress it. You just don't know what to do. But by creating an awareness of the whole dance, and by making it less personal, so it's not just your sub-personality out here, this sub-personality is also a reflection of an archetype, and these archetypes are universal. So you have trouble with your mother? Guess what? The mother archetype has been giving humanity trouble for the last 250,000 years. You know? So or your father, or whatever it is, your son, your daughter. So yes, you look at the gods on Olympus, they were always fighting and arguing, you know, or the Hindu gods. So strife is the condition of the sub-personalities. But by becoming more aware, we get a little more navigation room. I like the original meaning of wisdom in Greek, referred to the navigator who held the rudder. And the idea was that in the storms of life, you can't control the storm, but wisdom is gradually increasing the skill to steer your way. So if you're in a 30-year marriage, for example, one of the things that hopefully you both learned how to do is to avoid the hot button issues by, you know, steering your way through the minefields that, you know, exist in any long-term relationship, and which, of course, reflect different sub-personalities from our boarding houses in conflict. But if we can steer well, maybe we can do a better job of avoiding something. Unless we get off on fighting, and that's another archetype. Any other questions?
You talked about personalities. I'm curious, when in Western medicine we heal the symptoms typically, and I find when you step out and you're also healing on an emotional level as well, we are looking at the archetypes, you're really healing, like the mother wound, you can use this example. Do you have any suggestions on how to heal holistically instead of just looking at, I'm trying to forgive my mother for this, but healing as a whole person in those aspects in a way? Because I find that we try to heal the way we try to treat cancer, and we only target one thing, we miss the whole thing.
So the question was, is there a holistic way of looking at symptoms and wounds like the mother complex rather than the Western way of just working with the symptom, right? Is there a holistic way of doing that? It's a great question. I think that what I would say is there are many, many, many different ways of working holistically. And every great tradition has a way. So, you know, traditional Chinese medicine, African medicine, you know, indigenous folk medicines from around the world. So there are ways that deal with the physical dimensions, which are usually more holistic, like traditional Chinese medicine, just to use that example, is a much more holistic approach to symptoms than Western medicine. But these holistic visions typically address not only the physical body, but also the emotions, the mind, and the spirit. So I wouldn't say that one way, but there's a tremendous number of ways. And the question is, it's not necessarily which system you work in, it's how skillful you are in that system. And what is the match between the healer's skill and the belief system and needs of the client or the patient? So, you know, you may have 20 people who use Acciaiuoli's psychosynthesis, and of those 20, you know, 5 you'd never want to go near, 10 are okay, and 5 are extraordinary, you know, something like that. There's a distribution curve. So it isn't so much to me what system it is, but how adept the practitioner is with it, and whether there's a good fit between that practitioner and the patient. One more, and then let's go to the reception. Yeah, no.
Well, this is another question.
Yeah, let's see. Is there somebody who hasn't spoken? Let's wait a second for somebody a little quieter. No disrespect.
We understand.
Okay, Don, you got it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I was thinking about, the quest to find out who we are and what best serves us. Mm-hmm. Could you say something about the struggle, another kind of struggle, and that is we're surrounded by culture with a whole lot of different messages. Television, politicians are trying to evoke a certain side of us in order to get a vote. Movies, literature. What is the preferred way of living? How do you wade through all that? Because these are very powerful forces that are coming down on us.
So the question was, how do we wade through all the forces of advertising and politics and everything else that try to evoke certain responses in us in the search for whatever we mean by our true self?
Now, I'm pretty angry that you're... The way you restated it is a lot better than what I said.
That's my job. I was visiting with a friend this weekend, an old friend, and we were comparing our styles of doing that. And in the Enneagram, our styles were both, I told you, they're 9 different types, the true believer, the helper, the performer, the tragic romantic, the observer, the devil's advocate, the epicure, and the peacemaker. And the two of us discovered, we've known each other for a long time, that we're both observers. And the observer processes everything through the mind. They tend, in response to challenge, to withdraw. They don't like too much attention being paid to them. And they're most at home with ideas and books. That's a short version. So my way of processing the world, of those 9 different types, is the observer. Now, in the Enneagram, it says, when I'm stressed, there's an arrow that goes to the epicure. I want to kind of do everything. And when I'm feeling safe, there is, where's the arrow? I forgot. That one of the other points. The reason I mention that is that I honestly don't think there is one way to do this. I think it depends on whatever authentic places we can find within ourselves, whether our principal response to the world is to help people or be out in the world building something or, try to be as good as we can. We all have these different motivational core drives. The theory is that we each have a core drive. I'm not 100% sure that's true. We can't help but being influenced by the culture. And actually, one other thing I want to say in that regard is something my colleague Rachel Naomi Raman talks about, is that deep healing takes place in community. It's a friend of mine, Francis Weller, says, it's the work that we must do alone that we can only do in the company of others. So there's this enormously powerful thing, whether you find it in a church or a support group or a group of friends, that to do deep healing, it's very, very hard to do it by yourself. There has to be some kind of healing circle. And that healing circle can vary in the skill with which it's done. And in fact, a large part of what Shanti and I and others at Smith Center and Commonweal and 2 other centers that based on Commonweal that are also celebrating their 20th anniversary, Harmony Hill in Washington State and the center up in Vancouver, British Columbia. What these places have in common is a dedication to extraordinarily high quality intentional healing using circle work. So what I would say is, there's not a single way for each of us to do it, but if we sit in a circle where respectful listening is the heart of it, we're not going to advise others or tell them what to do, but we create a space where we can hear ourselves, that the way to a true life in some way is to find those circles somewhere, whether in the church, whether with friends, whether people with the same loss, or people with different losses. Alcoholics Anonymous is an incredibly brilliant example, one of the great inventions of the 20th century, of people who discovered that with all their differences, if alcoholism was their common bone, in a circle they could heal. And the healing circles work is really about, can we create high quality circles like that that are free or as close to free as possible everywhere where people with cancer or other losses want to create them. And that's one vision that I'd ask you to hold and take home with you. Finally, I just want to say, just as we can't heal by ourselves, we can't sustain Smith Center without. So if you care about what you find here, if you can leave some prayers with us or find a way to support the work in some way, there's a way in which being of service to others in whatever way we can is the most powerful healing work that we can do. That's what the shamanic experience is, that it was only by serving others that we could really heal. So, help us heal Smith Center and Village Center. Thank you all, and God's bless.
Like walking the labyrinth, for those of you that have had that experience, you lead us through this path so carefully into areas that we don't quite know where you're going or where we're going, but follow you, and you guide us into this place, right? That's different than we were in when we came into the room and we're in this place together. And everything in me always wants to not put more words after that. So thank you so much, Michael. And the other thing that really struck me tonight was your phrase about the purpose of this is to expand our inner resources to live more spaciously. To find and use those inner resources which are there, which you so assure us all these different ways, to live more spaciously. And we feel that right now, right? And what that means to live with more truth, with more hope, with more grace, with more health, with more community, with more knowledge of who we are. So thank you. That's just extraordinary. Thank you. And as I've said before, and I'll say again, there would be no Smith Center without Michael. Mm. So we are all so deeply grateful. So if I may make a few sort of mundane announcements, just a couple. I want to welcome some new friends, certainly welcome friends that we've known from the beginning. So Michael introduced some of our board members here. I also want to introduce two of our Vikings. We are just entering our 20th year, so 19 years ago we did the first week-long Cancer Help Program retreat based on Michael's pioneering model at Commonweal. And Don Sauter and Georgia Irvin were two of our very first participants in our first retreat 19 years ago. They named themselves the Vikings. So I just want you to stand up, if you will. John's wife Judy, who is a Viking wife. So I just wanted to say, if you want to know more about the programs here, if you're not on the mailing list, please sign up. There's some sign-up sheets here. There's a mailing list for the gallery and a separate mailing list for the cancer support programs. And just if anyone is interested or know someone who's interested, we have a day-long retreat coming up, a cancer support retreat, day-long this Saturday. There's still, I think, a space or two. In about a month or 3 weeks, there's a three-day cancer support retreat here, which there is still some space available. This Thursday night, there's a cooking class, Eating for a Lifetime, with our extraordinary Laura Pohl, who's been with us almost since the beginning, our singing chef. And we have someone translating into Spanish also for that cooking class here Thursday night. And a number of other wonderful programs coming up, so you can look at the website or take a hold of our printed brochure. We have lots of ongoing yoga classes available to everyone. I just want to say the briefest word about the implicit bias exhibit that we're in the middle of. There's a brochure in the back if you want to know more. But Michael, since you were talking about the Pope, and he's very much in our hearts and on our minds right now, I heard a quote from him. He was trained as a scientist right early on, saying that science and faith are two ways to know the world. And I was really struck by that. And for me, I said, and yes, and also the arts. They're another way for us to both know the world and, like science and faith, to change the world where we feel it needs to be changed. And so that's sort of the reason why we use the arts here. It's a way to know the world and know ourselves and to change the world. So implicit bias is about some of what Michael was talking about, our own projections onto people unlike, that we think are different from ourselves. And during the implicit bias show, next week there's a panel which is about how the media shapes our perceptions of each other. And some extraordinary people on the panel, not this Friday, but next Friday. And some other artist talks and other things, including a movement workshop about changing our perceptions of each other. So again, Michael, I want to thank you so much for this evening. Yes?
Is this part of the exhibit or has this been recorded?
This is, what a great question. This bottom part, it is being recorded.
Okay.
So it will be available.
All right.
And what's not turned down there is one of our artists went to the local police, I don't know what's in the news, and had a body cam on and spent a day with the police videotaping that, and has a body cam on himself for the duration of the exhibit for a couple of months. So that's what's on that, those cell phones on the wall. But we are recording this. And if you email me, we'll let you know how you can get a copy of this. So now, if I can invite you all to join us in the Barbara Smith room. And Michael, you were talking about Barbara's spirit. I do believe and feel that she is here with us tonight and that she's very happy. So please join us for some wine and food and company in the Barbara Smith room. Thank you.
Thank you.